Atlanta Kincaid is this year's Volunteer of the Year. Give her a hand. Lana was not there at the banquet last night because she volunteered to watch everybody's kids while they went to the banquet. But we have a gift for her today, and I think we should just take a moment. I'm going to read to you this plaque that we have for you. And this gift bag has all these different things in it, and the poem relates to the gift bag. Are you ready? To the Volunteer of the Year, Lana Kincaid, you truly are a saint. Good deeds you've done and hearts you've won with never a bad complaint. You're a blessing to those around you with your unselfish acts of love. We pray God pours out His blessing from heaven up above. This gift we give you today was made with you in mind because you are so thoughtful, so giving, and so kind. Inside this box, you will see an assortment of gifts for you because you are so reliable to the work of God. It's true. The first thing you will see is a clock made out of wood. It represents the time you've spent. Everything you do is good. You'll also find a candle. Its light you shines bright. It's all because your spirit and your attitude is right. The candy says how sweet you are, and the planner is to help you out. And the book is full of knowledge, just like you, no doubt. Today we honor you, my friend. Hats off to you, we cheer, for you truly are deserving of the Volunteer of the Year. And there you go. That's a gift for David to Steak and Ale. And this is a basket of all kinds of goodness. All kinds of goodness. And he's going to carry this down for you. Let's give Lana another hand. Thank you, Lana. Thank you. Ushers are coming this morning. God bless you. You can be seated. We are blessed today to have Brother Charles Mahaney with us. He is the leader of the United Pentecostal Church's prison ministry. He is also a writer on things relating to Christianity and Judaism. He is also, his background is Jewish, and we are blessed to have him today. He's also a quite accomplished humorist. I say humorist because that sounds a lot more distinguished than a comedian. And he worked in the banquet last night. And really, just so funny, and we're so glad that he's here today. Jesus, Lord, so much is happening, Lord, with the Volunteer of the Year banquet, God.
Thank you. clap our hands unto the Lord this morning, for he's worthy. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. If memory serves me correct, this time of year, about mid-November, I believe it's Evangel College, has an assignment for many of their students to come to non-Assembly of God Pentecostal churches to do a study. Are there any crusaders in the house this morning? Raise your hand. Let's give the crusaders a hand. Glad you're here. Hallelujah. Don't believe what they said about us. I promise we're nice people. I promise, I promise, I promise. God bless you. We're glad you're here. We're blessed to have Brother Charles Mahaney and his son, Nick, with us today. Brother Mahaney has been to the Holy Land. He's been to Israel 35 times. He's the author of many books, and he is a speaker of renown amongst the United Pentecostal Church. We're glad to have him. Let's give Brother Mahaney a great Springfield welcome. He'll make you laugh. He'll make you cry. We're glad he's here.
Sister Piazza, good to see you. Hallelujah. About 3.5 years ago, or 2.5, it'd be 3 years in March, was one of the greatest years of my life. Number one, my son that had been out of church 20 years came back. Hallelujah. Number two, Yasser Arafat went home to be with Allah. Hallelujah. And my wife and I were believing God for Nick to come back, and I had one of these preachers that preach against everything but fresh air that come to me and said, I wouldn't put up with that junk if he was my son, Mahaney. And I said, I wouldn't either if he was your son, ignorant. Hallelujah. But Nick came back, and he's going to sing for you. He's got a couple CDs out there. And he's anointed of God, traveling with his dad. And I was griping at him the other day about something, and he said, that mantle's getting harder and harder to get, Dad. Hallelujah. You may be seated.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I'm thankful for the grace and the glory of God that can reach down and take an old backslider for 20 years out there shooting meth, snorting meth, smoking meth. I throwed it up under the air and ran up under it if I could have. And he reached down in a drug rehab, and I didn't have to make up any fancy prayers. I just said, Jesus, forgive me. If you're here today and you've got anything binding you, we've got a God that can deliver you. He will come. He will work with you one-on-one. And he will deal and walk with you in quiet places, and he'll deliver you. I know right now there's victory in Jesus. Worship with me. Well, I heard an old story. Savior came from glory. How he gave his life upon Calvary. But to save, he saved a wretch like me. Well, I heard about his groaning of his prayer. Atoning. Well, that's when I repented of my sins. You see, I won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. 'Cause he sought me and he bought me. heard about those streets of gold way beyond the crystal sea. Well, it's about the angels singing that old redemption story. And some sweet day I'm gonna sing up there a song called victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. Tricia Piazza with us. We've known her since she was a little girl, and she went through all the stuff the rest of the kids did. She just hit it better. Hallelujah. Praise God. Everybody say Shema. Yisrael. Adonai. Eloheinu. Adonai. Echad. No, Echad. Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Hallelujah. I was driving down the street in another state, another city, and I saw there's a TV, a Christian TV station with a bookstore. So I thought I'll go and look at their books. And I walked in, and a guy looked at me, and he stared at me, and he said, "Are you Charles Mahaney?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Are you the author of the book, He's My God, Too?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "We've been studying that on our Christian TV station. Could we interview you for about 10 minutes? And I said, "Sure." I went in, and 2 hours and 55 minutes later, we were still sitting there taking call-ins on. Somebody said, "Well, what do UPC think about you being on television?" I said, "How are they going to know?" Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Nick's got a couple, what do you call them, DVDs, CDs, out there. And then I got my book, He's My God, Too, and a brand new book, The Joy of Recovery. And praying for the prodigals. This is a young man that took Brother T.W. Barnes's church. And there's so much that we've got that we can reference to today. But this book right here shed a lot of light on those commentaries. Genesis 21, verses 1 through 6. I realize the only thing standing between you and lunch is me. They gonna put it up on the giant screen TV here. Hallelujah. It's not a TV. Hallelujah. Although I wish we were on this morning broadcasting around the world. Yeah. Hallelujah. Genesis 21, verses 1 through 6. Wave your Bible at the devil anyway. It makes him nervous. And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did unto Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son that was born unto him whom Sarah bare to him, Isaac. Let's use his Hebrew name here. His real Hebrew name is Itzhak. Everybody say Itzhak. It means hilarious laughter. And Abraham circumcised his son, hilarious laughter. He could laugh because he was young enough, he didn't know what that's doing to him. Being 8 days old, as God had commanded him. And Abraham was 100 years old when his son, hilarious laughter, was born unto him.
And Sarah said, God hath made me to laugh, so that all that hear me will laugh with me. I want to preach just a little while this morning on a revival of joy. A revival of joy. Turn around and give the one beside you a high five and say, cheer up a little bit. You may be seated in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you what, I'm in an organization of several thousand preachers, and it's hard being in an organization like that when you're the only guy with a personality. Joy. Joy. Come on, everybody's looking for something that'll make them happy. And nothing will make you happy except the Lord Jesus Christ. At the lowest point in Abraham's life, his name was Abram, which means a father, a great father. And when God got ready to change his life, he called him Abraham, took the fifth letter of the Hebrew alphabet, which is grace, and put it in his name, hallelujah, and changed his name from Abram to Abraham because God wanted him to have grace and joy. Come on, God wants his people to know real joy. I wake up in the morning with joy. Come on, somebody said, you never wake up grumpy? And yeah, sometimes I let her sleep. Hallelujah. But at the lowest point in Abraham and Sarah's life, God birthed laughter. I don't care what you're going through. I know a God that wants to birth laughter into your spirit today. Come on. God woke me up at 5 o'clock this morning and said, I'm ready to birth something into this church that's going to draw people off the interstate and everywhere. See, nothing happens in the natural realm that's not birthed in the spiritual realm first. When God was getting ready to deliver Israel from Egypt, Pharaoh said, you can go, and then he brought him back. You can go, and then he brought him back. You can go, and then he brought him back. The rabbis teach that was the birth contractions that God was birthing Israel. I've got 3 kids, all 3 born on August the 29th. We're oneness. Hallelujah. See, the church doesn't want to be with child today because when you're with child, all the schedules are off. You don't go skiing a whole lot down the black slope. Come on. And the church doesn't want to be with child. You swell. Every day's a bad hair day. Speaking of bad hair days, hallelujah. I remember when our first son was born, Nick, and we got everything ready, had a little suitcase packed, and had the number for the hospital, the doctor, had the car ready with gas. And my wife told me one day, she said, Mahaney, we better get to the hospital. I ran out, jumped in the car, peeled out, run 2 red lights, had the bag in the car and everything, and looked over and realized I left my wife back at the apartment. Hallelujah. When Nick was born, my dad come up and said, let's go see the boy. And what does he look like? And I said, he's ugly, Dad. Hallelujah. He said, you ought to have seen you when you was a boy. But God takes natural relationships to show us spiritual relationships. Come on. See, God took a mother, which is the church, a father, which is the strength of the church, a husband and wife to show the relationship between he and his bride. I came home a while back, went by the graveyard and got some flowers for my wife, and I
I take her to Sam's Club on Friday afternoon. You get all the free samples, and I take her to lunch. And I bought her at our 20th wedding anniversary, I bought her a little ring with a diamond in it that named after the city I live in, Little Rock. And but you know what? There's joy in a new birth. You know what I felt this morning when we was when the pastor was admonishing us and kicking us a little bit and jacking us up a little bit? You know what I thought about? There's always comes a time of mourning and joy before the birth. And God is birthing something. God has always wanted his people to know real joy. Come on. We go to church like we're going to the prison farm or something. I've seen happier faces on iodine bottles. Yesterday was Veterans Day. Several years ago, they was having Veterans Day in a church where I was preaching. They had plaques for the veterans, and a little boy walked in with his dad and said, "What's these plaques?" He said, "That's for men that died in the service." He said, "Was it the morning service or the evening service?" Come on, we're not serving a dead God. We're not serving Buddha or Allah. I don't care what you're going through. I'm serving a God that wants to birth laughter into your life and joy into your life. The Bible said he went to the cross for the joy that was set before him. That cross brought him joy, not the nails in his hands, but what the cross was purchasing. Come on, nothing could change a person but the blood of Calvary. We was in a prison a few months ago, and in one service we baptized 127 women in Jesus' name in a women's prison, and 97 of them came out of the water speaking in tongues. Them old gals, every one of them wanted to come up and hug the chaplain. I'm talking about lesbos and hookers and hallelujah. Their teeth had rotted out and tattoos and orange coveralls. God didn't care what they looked like. Come on, we got to get that out of our mind. God doesn't care what that sinner looks like. My wife, she's a very unpretentious woman. Unless you act like you throw a bug on her or something, hallelujah. And my wife and the worker she goes with has baptized over 4,000 in Jesus' name. Come on. I'm talking about joy. You know why the joy is not in the church? It's a synthetic joy if there's no birth taking place. But when birth begins to take place, there's a real joy that comes to their church. Come on. He said, "My joy might remain in you, that your joy might be full." One of the gifts of the Holy Spirit is joy. Come on, the Bible said the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Solomon said there's a time for everything, a time for weeping, a time for stacking up stones, and a time for throwing away stones. And he said there's a time for joy. Come on, I believe God's going to birth a revival of joy. I wouldn't have wanted what most people got if somebody would have come to me like that. The guy that won me to God was crazy. Brother Stanford, you ever meet Brother Stanford from Boston? Not Boston, Boston, hallelujah. Mean as a junkyard dog. Got one eyebrow goes plumb across the front of his head. If it looked good, tastes good, or any fun, he was against it. I got put in jail after I was a preacher on an old charge I'd done before I was a preacher. I said, "You got a new man." They said, "You look like the old one to us, so we're going to take you to jail." And you know what? I sat there in that jail cell, and I had the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, you can have joy in a prison cell. You can have joy in a cancer ward. Come on, Paul said, I glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. What's the matter with that little Meshuggah Jew? I glory in my infirmities. Paul said, when I get sick or I'm in a jam, I glory in that. That's when I really get to going, because I know that through that, when I look the worst, God is going to look the best. Come on, when I've done everything I can do, then God's going to do what he can do. See, I've spoken in several church growth seminars and different things, and our concept of church growth is different than the biblical concept of church growth. We get guys to go back to the peer group that they come from to witness. African Americans go back to the African American Hispanic. Why do you think they asked me to be the general chaplain of the United Pentecostal Church for prisons? Wasn't because I was the head of a Girl Scout troop. Come on. Why do you think they asked me to be the leader of the Jewish outreach? I got an Uncle Isaac that's been going out of business for 47 years. If it wasn't for the Jews, you'd still be paying $10 instead of $9.99. We had two gangs in my neighborhood. We had a gang called the Warlords, and we had our Jewish gang called the Landlords. But you take a Spanish guy, he goes back to the Spanish. A dope head goes back and Nick's teaching Acts class, and he's prayed his parole officer through to the Holy Ghost, and she's been baptized. Prayed his drug counselor through to the Holy Ghost, she's been baptized. But you know what? Jesus assigns people differently. If I would have been Jesus and I was going to assign somebody to reach the Jews, the most intellectual people that ever lived. Come on, if it wasn't for a Jew named Salk, we wouldn't have a polio vaccine. If it wasn't for a Jew named Einstein, we wouldn't have a theory of relativity. Come on. All three of the Three Stooges were Jewish, and they blessed me all my life. Still bless me once in a while. Paul had the equivalent of 5 PhDs. Phi Beta Kappa Chi, Rhodes Scholar, one of the most brilliant young rabbis that ever came out of Jerusalem. And I'd send him to the Jews so he could get up there and talk about homo sapiens who reside in crystallized domiciles should hesitate to project projectiles through the atmosphere, and I hesitate to articulate lest I deviate from this present course of rectitude, and I must cease from my verbiage lest I become inebriated on the exuberance of my own verbosity. And I must cease lest I wax truculent and pugnacious in my bloviating. That's who I'd have sent to the brilliant Jews. You know what they done? They got old ignorant Peter up there. Come on. And then they needed somebody to reach those heathen Gentiles that believed in three gods. Come on. First thing I've ever learned when I was a kid growing up was Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one Lord. Nick and I were on Hollywood Boulevard a couple weeks ago, and we was out there, and it was Halloween night, and all the freaks in the world were on Hollywood Boulevard in L.A. They had the Spider-Man, the Rubber Man, the I don't know what all, Michael Jackson out there, whatever he is, hallelujah. And there was a guy up there preaching, and he had a microphone preaching, and they had a microphone you could respond to him. So I stood there and listened a while, had a good crowd of people, and he said, anybody got anything you'd like to say? And I said, yes, I do. He said, what? And I said, I appreciate you being out here. preaching to these people, all these freaks out here on Hollywood Boulevard. But I said, I think it's a shame you don't preach the truth to them. He said, what do you mean? I said, you're trying to make these people believe in a three-God concept. And I said, you'll never get a Jew to believe in three gods. And they're so help me, there's a little Jew standing there. He said, that's right. He said, I'm a Jew, and I wouldn't accept Christianity because you tried to run the Trinity down my throat. Hallelujah. And we stood there, me and that Jew, and we had a little schmoozing time. Hallelujah. Listen, our world is hungry for that. They don't care about religion. Come on, they don't care about religion. They've got religion. Religion tries to bomb us. They want relationship. I was in the airport about 3 or 4 years ago, and I was in Cincinnati coming on one of them moving stairways, and I dropped my book, and I picked it up, and I was face-to-face with one of my heroes of the 60s, Muhammad Ali. Float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. Come on. He hit guys so hard that their hair looked like yours. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I looked at him and I said, hey, champ, you're one of my heroes. He just kind of mumbled something. I said, I want to pray for you. I'm a man of God. He nodded his head and I laid hands on him. I said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I started to pull my hand away and he put it back on his head, grabbed it, put it. Allah don't have anything that feels like this. Come on, hallelujah. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In thy presence is fullness of joy. With joy shall we draw waters from the wells of Jesus. Hallelujah. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Jacob, then was our mouth filled with joy. Hallelujah. Come on, the church needs a revival of joy if we're going to go out and reach people with what we got. Come on, people get the Holy Ghost and act like they're mad about it. I took an anger management course and got mad and quit. Hallelujah. See, as the church was formed, the church was Jewish. They kept kosher. Come on, there's things that we don't eat in Judaism. Somebody asked me, Jesus said, do you think I'll go to heaven eating pork? And I said, yeah, you'll beat me there about 7 years. Hallelujah. We've harped on a lot of things. It's not heaven or hell. It's do you want to be used of God and get closer to God? See, every one of those animals had an attitude in them that God didn't want to get in his people. An owl will sit on a limb and push every other owl off the limb. God said, don't eat an owl. Come on, an ostrich has wings and won't fly. There's something about that bugs God. A mule's backward about going forward. And the church was Jewish. They all wore prayer shawls and they came dancing to the temple and they were Jewish. But as the church moved west, the Gnostics and the Hellenists began to change the church. They couldn't wait for the last Jew to get off the leading place in the church, because then they could bring in a three-God concept. It wasn't Shema. It was Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Come on. And they changed it from Passover to Easter. Come on. Pesach to Easter. Come on, the reason they use a bunny rabbit, because rabbits have 87 little rabbits a day. The guy showed me something on the plane the other day. He showed me a little blurb in a magazine. He said, a woman has a baby every 4 minutes in the United States. And I said, somebody needs to stop her. Hallelujah. They changed Passover to Easter. They changed Hanukkah to Christmas. Come on, I don't preach against Christmas. I was whacking them one time at a
conference about Christmas, and I turned around and got down to pray, and God spoke to me and said, your attitude's worse than anybody that ever celebrated Christmas. He said, I can handle my ignorant little children celebrating my birthday on the 25th, but I can't handle your attitude. So I don't preach against Christmas anymore. If you want to take your kids out to the mall, stick them on some pervert's lap because he got a red suit on, then... Wouldn't let my wife get a Christmas tree and found out she was buying four of them, tearing them up and stringing them around the house. And it's taken us 2,000 years to get Pentecost. The Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, a rushing mighty wind. It's taken us 2,000 years to get it contained down into four or five little organizations. Come on, AG, UPC, Church of God in Christ, and whatever. Hallelujah. And we've got Pentecost figured out to three songs, a testimony, and a sermonette. That's why we got matches full of Christianettes. Come on. We've got it, the church user-friendly. I wouldn't be embarrassed to invite Bill Clinton into this place to worship with us. And I've worshiped with Bill Clinton. In fact, I was sitting with Bill Clinton when he said he was going to run for president. We thought it was a joke or something. I've laid hands on him and prayed for him. If I know what he's going to be, I'd have hung on longer. Come on. I wouldn't be. This is an awesome place. It's good worship. Y'all look so nice. And they got this nice hairdos here. And the music's awesome. Come on. Got three jugs up here. I don't know what the ushers shook hands. And last night when I come into the banquet, Joe Boyd White shook hands with me. This morning he shook hands. Why do you get the ugliest guys to be hosts? That's what I don't understand. And this church is user friendly. Nobody should feel out of place here. Like he told the young men, the Assembly of God are third cousins from us. We all used to be the same organization. Come on. I sat down on an airplane the other day, I was sitting on the aisle, and the guy was sitting by the window, and there was a seat next to us, and the pilot said, we're going to have a little delay. So I got my Bible out, and I said, let me tell you something. He said, no need. He said, who are you? And I said, I'm a UPC evangelist. He said, I'm Assembly of God evangelist. And I said, let me tell you something. He said, no need. He said, I've already been baptized in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we had fellowship. We had revival on the airplane. Come on. See, the Greeks believed that all matter was evil. And as the church moved west, they left the Jewish influence. And the church today is more Greek than it is Jewish. When the Jews had Passover, they drank four big glasses of wine. We ought to come to church and act like a Jew that's just drunk four glasses of wine. And they believe all matter is evil. They believe the body's evil. So therefore, you shouldn't clap your hands, lift your hands, leap for joy. And the Jews believe that we're made in the image of God. We're made to worship God. When God created man, he breathed into man the breath of life, man, nefesh, the breath of life. But when he made Adam, he breathed into him neshamach, which means a communicating spirit like God. We're made to communicate with something. Come on. You'll never be happy unless you're communicating with something higher than you. I was having dinner a while back with Keith Jostrand. Piazza's know him. He's a clinical psychologist. I worry about those guys. I feel like they're always looking into me or something. I'm not going to be paranoid, even if everybody is out to get me. I promise. Hallelujah. And Keith told me, Charlie said, you know what? He said, we found out the whole psychiatric profession
is excited because there's a part of your brain that never opens up until you worship or praise. It's closed, but when you worship and praise, it opens up a part of your brain to the consciousness and the Spirit of God that never opens up any other time. Come on, God wants his tabernacle of David restored in these last days. I told a camp meeting this summer, I said, if you expect me to ask you to worship God, you'll sit there and you got to get a skin graft to get you off the bench. It's not worship if we've got to ask you to worship. Come on, we preachers, we alibi for you. Well, there's high praise and low praise. Ain't no such thing in the Hebrew. It's just, it's all high praise. And if we've got to ask you to worship, it's not worship. When I get off an airplane, I slide into the car, got my hair all sprayed down, and if we prayed as much as we sprayed, we'd have revival then. And I say, honey, do you love me? And she pats my little fat hand and said, yeah, Mahaney, I love you. Don't mean much. Come on. But when she just reaches over and said, I love you, Charlie. Brrr, hallelujah. It don't mean much if we've got to beg you to worship God. Would you please worship God? You know what? Somehow Jesus has got it in his mind that this whole thing ought to be about him. I don't know where he didn't get it from us. Hallelujah. Come on. We've changed the upper room to the supper room. We're not standing on the promises. We're sitting on the premises. We're more pathetic than prophetic. We got more fashion than passion. Come on. I don't care if you got to tell me what's his finger necktie on or what. You've come to worship him like the pastor says. And that's when the church is doing battle. John 10:10 said, the thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and to destroy. See, Jesus sets the perimeters. Jesus sets the rule. He can't kill and destroy you unless you let him steal something from you. Come on. And he's give you joy. And if he can take your joy, he can kill your testimony. He can steal your righteousness. It don't take one of these guys that tell you where you lost your keys in here to some of these evangelists to tell you who's going to be the next in Brother Padgett's office. I can tell you. It's those that you've let him steal your joy already. Come on. When he steals your joy, you've opened the gate and he can come in and kill and destroy you. But Jesus said, I have come that you might have life. See, Paul in the Mamertine prison, I've been to Rome 8 or 9 times. They took us down one time into that Mamertine prison, and the Catholic priest, we walked in there, and it was where Paul spent 4 years and wrote 4 books of the Bible. 3 floors below the ancient streets of Rome. The Roman Catholic priest told us they kept Paul chained between soldiers. And they said sometimes they'd have to change the guards on Paul 2, 3, 4 times a day. And I said, why? He said, because Paul would have his guards converted because of the joy that was on his life. And every one of those tombs in the catacombs and in the Mamertine prison underneath the Rome where the martyrs died had a fish and some kind of a Greek writing on it. And I asked the priest, I said, what does that mean? He said, it's not relevant in today's society. And I said, what's that mean? He said, it literally means Jesus is God. I turned around, I said, that's our people in there. Hallelujah. Come on, that's our people in there. And I asked the priest, I said, if we'd go back into some kind of a time warp, a quantum leap, if you would. I don't know how that phrase came to me, a quantum leap. We could see somebody baptized. We could see Paul baptizing his converts. They said that when the Tiber River got waist deep, it flooded, they would let the Canadas down on a rope and Paul would baptize them in his prison cell. Think about that. And I said, if we go back into, and the Roman Catholic priest, an emissary from the Vatican, told me, said, they used an ancient archaic formula that has no relevance to the church today. I said, I'm going to ask you another question. Why did they wait till the water got waist deep to baptize? I asked that Catholic priest. I said, one of our preachers was preaching in one of them sprinkling churches and reached over and got a cup of water and drank it. And the pastor said, good God, man, you just drank the baptistry. Hallelujah. I said, if we go back in time and see Paul baptize those people, what would Paul literally say when he put them under the water? He said, it's an ancient formula, but the church changed it. The mother changed it, he said. And I said, that's why we've stayed with the Father. He said, Paul would actually say, I baptize you into the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And you know what? They told us that all the human waste and stuff from the three floors up would run down into Paul's cell, and Paul would have to put his manacled arm up there to stop it to eat his food. And in the midst of that, Paul said, I thank myself happy. Come on, you know where your joy starts? Right in here. Right in here. You always react to your strongest inclination. When I was in the world, somebody pushed me, I pushed him back. Come on. When I was 16, they took my juvenile rights and put me in with the adults in jail. They pushed me, I pushed back. I didn't want to be the prom king of the cell block. It's not funny when you're in there. I come from a neighborhood, somebody said something, you'd say, yo mama. Hallelujah. Push back. But Paul said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know what God does? He walks in there, kicks down the strongholds, and brings a brand new spirit in there. Hallelujah. You see, what you're thinking about right now is your consciousness, and what you're not thinking about is your subconscious. And everything that's ever happened to you is dumped into your subconscious. And you cover it up with your thoughts. But just a smell, a sound, a song can bring out all that up out of your subconscious. I was driving through Dallas a few years ago, and I clicked on the radio. I was trying to find out what time it was, and somebody said, just trying to find the score. I don't care who wins the ball game. Nick's, who won last night, Nick? What do they call it, the pigs? Hog. I don't care. I was going up to Stan Gleason's last year, and I got on the plane. The pilot said, I had my Bible, and the pilot said, a holy man, huh? And I said, no, not really, just trying to live for God, Bubba. He said, if you can tell me what the score will be, he said, I'll let you ride in first class. And I said, I can't tell you what the score will be when the game's over, but I said, I can tell you what the score will be before it ever starts. He said, what? And I said, 0-0 before the game starts. My wife and I was watching him get on the ski lift, and I slipped and fell, hurt myself watching him get on the ski lift. Come on. I'm not into all this stuff, but I'm going to tell you something. I was riding on a plane with, what's the Dallas Cowboys name that was such an awesome ball player that they traded off, and he goes to T.D. Jakes' church now? Deion Sanders. And I was riding on a plane with Deion. And he said, what kind of preacher are you? And I said, a humdinger, buddy. Hallelujah. And he said, I'm interested in prison ministry. And I said, you sit here talking to the head of the prison ministry. The stewardess come by and said, you want us to take an offering? Well, we was having church on that airplane. And I said, yeah, I'll hit Deion. He's got money. I don't have any. I prayed years ago, keep me poor and humble. God's kept me humble, and churches have kept me poor. Hallelujah. And I said, let me ask you a question, Dion. When you win a, what do they do it in football, home run? Touchdown. My people own the teams. We don't play on them. When you do a touchdown and you give that high five, what does that mean? He said it means you're transferring some of the victory that you've just won in the heat of battle to your teammates. I said, oy vey. He said, what? And I said, whatever. Hallelujah. I said, now I know why we lift our hands when we come to church. Come on, you lift your hands. You know what God does? He transfers some of the victory that he won at Calvary into your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is a communicating God. And I turned the radio on and a song came back. It was the last song my brother and I listened to before my brother died of an overdose of drugs. Only brother died of an OD. And it was, I see a bad moon arising. Creedence Clearwater Revival. Come on. Somebody said, you ever go to Branson? I never could get drunk enough to like country music. Had a guy pass out one day, and I told my brother, I thought he was, his eyes rolled back, and I said, give him some CPR. And he said, I see a bad, I said, not CCR, CPR, ignorant, hallelujah. See, just a word cannot bring all that up. And that's why we've got to renew our mind to the Word of God, because God wants to destroy all those strongholds. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Casting down imaginations. Come on, I grew up poor. How many here grew up poor? We ate cereal with a fork so the next guy could use the milk. And we had running water. My dad would say, run and get some water. Hallelujah. My grandfather was a Jew that was a merchant in St. Louis that come down through the Missouri Hills in 1912 and 13 playing the violin and selling stuff. Come on, we can sell. And his name was Mahanaheim. And met my grandmother and went back to St. Louis. And I've never known my grandfather. I've never known my father's people. When I was a kid in school, they chose everybody else before me on the ball teams. Nobody wanted a fat little kid. Hallelujah. Come on, all the fat people say amen. Part of recovery is coming to yourself. Hallelujah, hallelujah. But you know what? God changed my life. My wife was hiding from me. I was mean. Been in jail 40 times. In the prison farm twice. Wore a black cape, sleeping in graveyards, freaking old ladies out. Come on, didn't walk in those days, I boogied. Hair bushed out, looked like I'd kissed a light socket. Black patch over my eye. And God reached into cell block J, cell number 14, and said, I love you. I don't care what you look like. Said, you, I don't care how filthy you've talked. Hallelujah. God put our home back together. Hallelujah. Come on. How can I not be joyful? We was in L.A. the other day, and we took Nick through there. I wanted him to see it. People living in boxes out there, Pastor, living in boxes. Living in boxes. When Paul hit a town, he wondered what jail he was going to be in. We wonder what hotel we're going to be in. Come on. I've actually heard preachers gripe because of the hotel people put them in. I've never done that. I stayed in one hotel and there was a roach in the sink and I called the desk. I said, you got a roach in here? And she said, is it dead? And I said, yeah. And she said, well, don't worry about it. I said, yeah, but there's 10,000 that's come to his funeral. Hallelujah. You know, it's contagious. People with joy is contagious. Come on. You can't be around people that's got joy and not that joy get on you. Go turn around to the one beside you and smile. God's got a sense of humor. If you don't think so, look at that one beside you. Joy. Joy. You don't know what I've been through, Brother Mahaney. I buried my little sister the other day. Went to her funeral, they was playing rock music, everybody outside smoking doobies. Buried my little sister. Had the joy of the Lord. Come on. Wrestled for 20 years for my son, and I wouldn't let the devil steal my joy. I was on a plane the other day, and the flight was so bad that people were screaming. I mean, screaming out loud. And I said, it'd be a good time to get a prayer meeting going, wouldn't it? And, well, they all come back where I was at. Hallelujah. And I sat there and had everybody laughing, the joy of the Lord. Joy. Joy. See, you're starting to smile. Some of you come in, look like your mother-in-law was moving in permanently or something. Joy. Come on, just reach your hands up and say, God, I need Isaac to be birthed in my life right now. God, I've been in the heat of the battle. I need Isaac to be birthed in my life right now. See, they came back and told Jesus, said, and now these are Jews. These are not guys from Missouri talking from guys to Arkansas. Jews talk with their hands. And our favorite word is oi. Oi, means good God, hallelujah. And they came back and they said, oi, Yeshua, even the demons are subject to us through your name. Disease leaves when we speak here. He said, don't rejoice over that. You rejoice because your name is written in heaven. And I saw Satan like lightning fall. And the Bible said Jesus rejoiced for the space of an hour. For the space of an hour, Jesus got out and rejoiced. There's two Hebrew words for joy. One means to sparkle. Yeah. Like when you honor your pastor. Beautiful sister that got the volunteer of the year. But there's another word for joy, and it's gila, gila. And it means to jump up in the air as high as you can jump and spin while you're jumping and clap your hands and holler at the top of your voice. And when it said Jesus rejoiced for the space of an hour, it said Jesus gilad. Hallelujah, over what we was going to have. Come on, for about an hour, Jesus was jumping up and down, clapping his hands. Saying, oy vey, hallelujah. Come on, stand and lift your hands. Stand and lift your hands to him. Praise God. Come on, let something be birthed right in here. Come on, I feel something yet unborn in this church trying to be birthed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know what our trouble is? We got drunk at Pentecost. We sobered up at Laodicea. At the turn of the last century, Nick and I was at Azusa Street a couple weeks ago in L.A. Got drunk again, and now we're into the 21st century facing everything hell can throw at us. The last thing that happens before a baby is born, the water breaks, and the water has broken across this world in tsunamis and earthquakes. Armies are encompassed round about Jerusalem. And Jesus said, when you see all that, pray Shiloh, Shalom, Yerushalayim. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Church needs to get drunk again. Come on, I'm not talking about Thunderbird or Boone's Farm or Strawberry Hill or Mad Dog 2020 or Old Charter or Old Granddad. Or I used to drink Aqua Velva shaving lotion. And we got some old moonshine drinkers in here. I can spot you. Got that line across your nose where you used to hold that fruit jar up there like that. See, we're not used to coming to church and having joy and laughing. We're used to coming to church and don't hit me, don't hit me. Hallelujah. I thought I was looking in the mirror for a minute there. Hallelujah. 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 Except I got better hair. Hallelujah. See, you're feeling something begin to lift. Isaac has been born in us. God's people are going through the battle. God's people are going through the battle. I talked to three preachers this Saturday, Friday and Saturday. Three of them. One is a very close friend of mine who's one of the greatest Christians I've ever known. He's got cancer that spread into his kidneys. And talked to another, and his wife had cancer. Now it's got into her spine and her lymph nodes. And I went into my wife, and she was sitting there, and I took her by the hand. I said, let's just rejoice. She said, why? And I said, we got health. We've got each other no matter what happens, and we've got each other to stand with each other. Come on. And most of all, rejoice, because I know his name. I know his name. I know his name. I'm talking to a man that was sitting at a red light, and you were sitting in your pickup truck and had your hands on the wheel, and you thought, I don't know what's going to happen if I don't get an answer. You're here because Isaac is getting ready to be birthed into your life. I'm talking to a lady that's a little alcove off of your kitchen, and you were sitting there and you was drinking tea. It wasn't coffee. I saw the tea bag out. You was drinking, and you said, I've got to have a revival among my kids and my family. Talking about a revival of joy. Here's the way I want to close this service. I want everybody in here to reach over and get somebody by the hand and bring them up around the front with you as quickly as possible. Right on up to the front, sister. Sweetheart, so people get up behind. Come on, right on up to the front. Front girl, some people get it. I'm going to tell you two things before we do this. Everybody in here has a king and a fool living in him. The king listens to the anointed word of God. The fool just blows it off. Come on. Do you know when Joshua sent, or when Moses sent the 12 spies, 10 of them come back shouting and said, or weeping, said, we can't do it. Now listen, in our eyes, we were as grasshoppers. They weren't really grasshoppers in our eyes. our eyes. Their self-perception made them impotent against their enemy in their own eyes. When God commissioned Israel, he never ever told Israel to count the number of the enemy, but count how much praise there is in Israel, because your victory is going to come according to the praise you have. Hallelujah. I'll tell you what I want to do. Some of you are going to have the Joseph syndrome. The last time Joseph saw his brethren, he was down here, and his brethren was looking down on him. The next time Joseph saw his brethren, Joseph was up here, and his brothers were down here. What's been looking down at you, you're going to look down at it before this year is over. Come on. We're going to get beyond all the shadows and all the clouds, because I believe the next year is going to be the greatest year of revival that this church right here has ever seen. God told me several months ago I was going to come to Springfield. God told me several months ago I was going to come to Springfield. Brother Padgitt was talking last night. He said, what, did you just get an opening in your schedule? And I said, no, God told me I was going to come to Springfield. God gives me my assignment. Told me I was going to come to Rex Johnson's and speak into his church, and Stan Gleason's, and speak into Stan's church. And God said, you're going to come to... So we was doing some fresh oil rallies, and Brother Coon was helping us, and I said, Carlton, call Springfield. And he said, they can't work it in. You remember when Hanscom or Brother Coon went, can't work it in. And I was praying at my desk. The phone rang, and said, this is Brother Padgitt from Springfield. I was running down the airport a while back with a black jogging suit on, and it said it's got an Israeli airplane on the front of it, and the word says, don't worry, America, Israel's behind you. Hallelujah. Somebody hollered Mahaney, and I turned around, it was Tom Foster, Dallas. He said, it's the will of God for you to come. And I said, God told me that in prayer, Tom. We went there and planted the seed, and God gave 789 brand new people a baptism of the Holy Ghost. I'm not talking about just stumbling into a place. I was preaching in Houston, Texas at Ronnie Macy's church, Rollwood Pentecostal Church. And we had a revival that exploded till we couldn't take care of it in the church. And we had to go, we rented a big gospel tent. They had a tent revival right outside the church. And one night, just before we moved into the tent, one of the elders of the church come up with tears running down his face and holding a Bible, and his hands were shaking. And I said, what's the matter, elder? And I put my arms around him and said, I love you, but what's the matter? He said, several years ago, he had it written down, God gave us a prophecy that we was going to have a revival so great that we couldn't contain it in the four walls of the church. And we'd have to rent a tent or move out of the church to have the revival. And I said, that's awesome. He said, wait a minute, I'm not through. He said, God even gave us the name of the man in that prophecy that was going to preach the revival. And I said, who was it? And he said, had it written down there. He spelled it M-A-H-A-N-E. He didn't know how to spell. But God said, I'm going to send a man that I'm going to bring forth named Mahaney to you. I was in the prison farm when that prophecy went. God spoke to me in my chair and said, you're going to Springfield. I'm going to birth something in this church. Hallelujah. I promise you it wasn't 15 minutes till a phone call and Brother Padgitt said, can you come? You know, we don't want to act like we're, well, I don't know, Padgitt. I don't know, Bo. Can you come? I don't know. I didn't want him to sound like I, you know, if you hold off and hard to get,
Makes the offering a little better, you know. He said, you don't know me but that well. I said, but if you want to call Stan Gleason or Chris Thornton, get some references, call them. And I said, we need references on Gleason and Thornton. What do you mean? Hallelujah. He said, would you pencil the date in? I said, I don't, yeah. I said, go, or said, can I? And I said, yeah, go ahead. And I hung the phone up. I said, yeah, you can pencil it in, write it in concrete, tattoo it on your arm, whatever you want to do. God is going to birth something this weekend in this church. Here's the way we're going to close this. When I count three, I want you to call Jesus just as loud as you can. I don't mean to say Jesus. I mean like he was in the storm and he was passing you by. I want you to call Jesus. When I count three, I want you to call. And you know what? The Holy Spirit's going to go look at the end of every situation. He's going to look at Kearney Street. The Holy Spirit's going to look at Campbell Street. And if you feel a witness in your spirit, I want you to worship God for about 60 seconds in a way your flesh won't even like it. Come on. Are you ready? I don't mean to say Jesus. I want you to call Jesus. One, two, three.
Jesus!
Come on. The Holy Spirit's looked at everything. Come on, if you feel a witness, I want you to shout before him. I want you to worship him in a way your flesh won't like it. Come on, shout before him. Shout before him. Come on. Satan has fallen. Enemies have fallen.
Whose
come on, Satan.
Report will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Whose report
we're
now
we declaring jubilee. We're declaring jubilee.
We shall the report of help me worship team. Whose report will you believe?